Hello, good morning, and welcome to the segment Renminbi, the real game changer. I'm Tamara Henderson. I'm Bloomberg's senior economist for Asia, and I'll be moderating the panel today. We have a distinguished panel, which I will now introduce to you. Directly to my left, we have Mr. Amol Gupte. He's Citi's regional head of treasury and trade solutions for APAC. Welcome. Next to him is Mr. Chen Wenyi, Bank of China's Deputy General Manager of Global Trade Services. Next, we have Mr. David Liao, HSBC's President and CEO for China. And on the far right, we have Dr. Andrew Chang, Distinguished Fellow for Asia Global Institute. So thank you, gentlemen, for coming. Before we get started, I just wanted to let the audience know that we have two items to share with you on the format of the panel. First, we are going to have a question and answer period at the end. So if you have a question in mind that you'd like to ask a panelist, please keep that in mind as we go along the session. The second item is that we are going to conduct an audience survey, and that will consist of three questions that we will ask during different phases of the session. And so I don't know, I'm sure you received this device, your chair, so let me just run through how it works. So when you get the question, each question will have an answer which will correspond to a number, so you will just push that number into the keypad. Now, if you wish to change your decision, you push the red triangle and that will clear your entry so you can push another response. So after we do the voting, we'll have about 10 seconds for the votes to be compiled and generated, and then we will see the results. So that is how it's going to work. So don't put your devices away yet. In fact, we need you to get them out because we're going to actually kick off our panel with our first question. So can we have our first question, please? Okay. From your perspective, is the RMB already a major international question? So you have three options. If you believe no, please press 1. If you believe yes, please press 2. If you don't know, please press 3. So please vote now. Okay, we have a no vote. We have 41% of no in the audience and 47% yes, and a few just not knowing. Okay, that's quite a split result. Now, if you will, take a look at the latest SWIFT transaction data for August. If I can have the slide, please. I don't know if some of you saw this already. We have in August, which are the latest data for transactions, August 2015, the renminbi displacing the yen, moving up into fourth place. This compares with 3 years ago, the renminbi being in 14th place 3 years earlier. So my first question, this sets up the first question for Dr. Sheng, the SWIFT data seem to suggest that the renminbi might be in the league of a major international currency, yet some in the audience seem to think some more work needs to be done. What would you say accounts for the divergence in your view?
Well, I think the renminbi is not yet officially, the capital account is still not open. So people think, well, you know, I can use it as a trade currency. But, you know, if the capital account is not open, I can't use it as freely as I can use the yen or the sterling or dollar or euro. But is the renminbi already a game changer? Absolutely. If it moves only 1.9% and the world market drops somewhere between 8 to 15%, it is a game changer. And the reason is very straightforward. China is already a $10 trillion economy, growing at 6% over 12 years. It'll double, so anywhere between 10 to 12 years, it'll double to a $20 trillion economy. The renminbi is a major currency, whether you like it or not. I think that's the issue. There are two, you know, issues whether renminbi will will become, as you say, the IMF included in the SDR basket. One is political, and the other one is technical. Let me talk about the political issue first. It's very clear that for Renminbi to join the SDR basket on the every five-year review, 70% will have to be voted for. And the recent visit of President Xi to the U.S., basically the U.S. and China agreed that the matter will be left to the IMF. So then it's no longer a political issue. That means the United States basically say, we will not object if the IMF does not object. I think that's a very key political tone that was sent. On the technical issue, the IMF considers it from a export perspective and a freely usable perspective. Now, these two criteria are absolutely important. From the IMF point of view, the renminbi already satisfied the export side. There's no question it already satisfies it. The key question then, is it freely usable? And freely usable, you know, is two parts. One, is it widely used? And the other one is widely tradable, right? Now, is it widely used? It's debatable. I mean, there's a lot of data that you've seen, what SWIFT has done, you know, brilliantly to show not only this move from number 14 to number 4, but the number of RMB clearing centers, the recent announcement of the trading net, the currency network that PBC has announced, it will be widely used. But is it freely tradable? Now, those are technical issues. And there's a whole tick list that the IMF has to go through. And the IMF has already agreed by 30th of September next year, given enough time, the People's Bank, I mean the Chinese and the IMF will have to make sure that all these boxes will be ticked. And I'm quite convinced that there will be a whole raft of measures that the Chinese will be doing to ensure that box will be ticked. And I would be very surprised if both from a political and a technical point of view, the RMB does not join the SDR basket.
How far do you think the Chinese authorities are willing to go, or at least intend to go, as far as liberalizing the renminbi?
Well, you've heard it right from the President Xi, Premier Li, the People's Bank Governor, the Minister of Finance. I think there's great commitment. And I think people don't quite appreciate this particular point. Before President Xi's visit to the US, I was very worried. If President Xi had come back and said, look, the US is not supportive of this, then the renminbi would be much more volatile, put it this way, much more flexible, much more volatile. But the minute the commitment was made on both sides that the renminbi will remain stable, I think, you know, number one, the People's Bank has more than enough reserves and the economy is still growing fast enough for them to maintain that. I believe it's very healthy for the world. And I think the reason why the markets have had a liftoff after President Xi's visit is precisely there was relief that there was commitment to renminbi's stability relative to the dollar.
Thank you. Mr. Gupte, as we see on the slide, the RMB overtook the yen in usage in August, and that was the same month that we had the liberalization of the daily RMB fixing. From your perspective, are these coincidence? Is this a coincidence, or are these related, or is there something else? And would this be sustainable?
So, Tamara, I think there is a linkage. I think with the recent weakening we saw, there is clearly some linkage. And, you know, in numbers, there's always some noise. So, I mean, what you see in this whole 2014-15 period is that the dollar strengthened a lot. Now, all these numbers that you see are all dollarized. And so you've seen a big shift from the euro to the USD, right? So the US dollar has gone up 600 basis points in its share. The euro has gone down 600 basis points. And that's because of the translation loss. So really, for me, whether it's 2.79, 2.76, whether it's number 3, number 4, number 5 is really unimportant. I think to Dr. Sheng's point, it is an incredibly relevant and important currency today. It will be even more relevant and even more important in the future. You know, as a practitioner, and we, as I talk to our clients, they're all incredibly focused on what more they can do. The one area I think we'd like to see much more liberalization is around the capital account convertibility, which is still very limited. You know, the CNH and the CNY are really different currencies. You can't commingle them easily. So I think it's just the start of the journey, and I think there's a lot more that needs to be done. But going back to your question, is it sustainable? Absolutely. I think it'll only grow, continue to grow from here.
Bringing this back to ASEAN, how has the internationalization of the renminbi so far impacted banks and companies operating in the region?
Well, I think a couple of ways, right? It has a whole, as it gets used, and when you think of a currency, I think about the journey in, you know, in three big buckets. I think of it as being a trade currency. And the trade currency, frankly, that box has already been checked. Then you think about the next phase of that journey as being the whole capital account convertibility as an investment currency. That's still early stage. And then I think the last stage is the whole reserve currency and getting included in the SDR basket. So I think in the second bucket, which is the capital account convertibility, in the third one, there's still ways to go. But the trade currency bit is where a lot of settlement gets denominated in the renminbi, has already happened, and it has a large downstream implication on the supply chain. So if you think about it from an ASEAN context, both for corporates and for banks, it has big implications because you're suddenly now taking risk on a currency that you weren't taking risk on. So you know you need to figure out how you need to invoice, you need to figure out how you need to hedge. And I think this is only the beginning of the implications for ASEAN. And I think the ASEAN countries will see an even bigger implication as the whole One Belt, One Road strategy goes through. And the whole maritime road that's going to be built will go through a lot of the ASEAN countries. And as that spend happens, we will see an even bigger implication in the ASEAN markets.
Thank you. Mr. Chen.
Yes, please.
Bank of China, as you know, is the official RMB clearing bank in half of the 16 offshore hubs opened around the world in the last 3 years. From your perspective, are you seeing similar patterns of RMB transaction demand in all of the hubs, or is each hub unique in its own way?
I think it's a very interesting question, right? Because, you know, I think you just trade renminbi as dollar. Because, you know, just different. The difference is only the currency, right? Which one? Dollar is issued by the states, renminbi is issued by PBOC, right? I don't think there's quite a lot of difference between them. The difference is only is that in, maybe it's the volume, right? Or they're recognized by the world, right? The dollar is number one, and according to your statistics, and RMB is not currently at number four, right? For your question, you mentioned the clear center, right? Bank of China already got half of the 16th. The latest one is Johannesburg, South Africa. Bank of China was announced by the PBOC as the clearing bank for the South Africa, right? Where I spent 3 years and 3 months in South Africa as the executive vice president of Bank of China Joburg branch. Definitely there's some difference between different clearing bank. For example, London, right, is famous for the financial foreign exchange business, right? And for Singapore here, maybe it's about commodity, right? Commodity finance is a commodity center, right? Then the renminbi was mostly used in the commodity business, right? And then for clearing business, the majority may be a commodity, right? And for South Africa, where I play a role in promotion renminbi to SAB, the central bank, right? And the central bank of SAB, of South Africa, they got approval from the PBOC to invest. It's around 15 $1.5 billion dollar to invest in China's interbank bond market. And another case in South Africa, which I finished, is about Old Mutual, which is a very famous insurance company, right? Old Mutual. They want to inject capital into China because there is a joint venture there, right? And because, you know, you know, currently the Renminbi has two markets. One is onshore, the other is offshore, right? For Joburg branch is offshore, right? Then we promote Renminbi to our client, to Old Mutual. We said that, okay, just do the transaction, which is convert dollar into Renminbi in Joburg on the offshore market, because the pricing at that time is good. And then remit Renminbi from Joburg to Shanghai to inject into their joint venture as capital injection, right? And the clients are very, very satisfied with our service. This is a character of South Africa, I think, right? But generally speaking, I think I like simple things, right? I don't think that a renminbi is a lot of difference from dollar. I think that they are different currencies. Maybe at this moment, just as mentioned, the volume is different, right? The status of trade used by traders as a settlement currency is different. But definitely, renminbi will catch up, right, slowly. Thank you.
Do you see that the hubs in ASEAN have any particular advantage or disadvantage?
ASEAN?
Yes.
Oh, definitely, ASEAN has an advantage. Definitely. Because ASEAN has a very good relationship both politically and economically with China, right? There's a trade flow. The volume is very quite big between China and ASEAN. And I think that China and ASEAN are negotiating the free trade agreement, FTA. Then if it's finished, then definitely the trade volume will boom. Yeah.
Do you think any more hubs will be opened in ASEAN?
Sorry?
Do you think any more hubs might be opened in ASEAN?
Of course, it's helpful for ASEAN countries, right? Because, you know, if you do trade with China, definitely you will benefit from those. You know, China don't want to dominate. China want to cooperate, just as our proposed like New Silk Road, right? Definitely. Not like TPP, right? TPP, maybe they want to do something, you know, to excluding China, right? But for the New Silk Road, we definitely want to involve more people. We want to play together, to cooperate together, to develop together, right? We didn't want to exclude anyone. Not like TPP.
Thank you. Mr. Leo, the RMB has come a long way, as we know, in terms of usage for trade flows. For practitioners, what are the critical hurdles on the capital account? Are there any specific measures that you can point to?
Yes. We've spoken a lot about the continued capital account restrictions that exist in China, and that's really the next big step. And I think capital accounts and investment flow will really be a theme for the next 5-10 years for China, and growing probably far more exponentially than trade. You know, despite all the controls, there are over $1.5 trillion of cross-border flows. And, you know, investments offshore and inbound are allowed. They are onerous in terms of the procedures and getting the relevant approval, but there are conduits. And from IMF's perspective, out of 40 criteria of capital accounts sort of opening up, China probably fulfills, to some extent, 35 of them. The real holy grail looking forward is really on the capital markets, both ways. As well as the sort of individual conversion, where it's now capped at about $50,000 per year. But focusing on the capital markets, you've seen throughout the past, well, really starting over 10 years ago with QFII, there are all these mechanisms coming into China's equity capital market and debt capital market through QFII, RQFII, Shanghai Connect, the pending Shenzhen Connect in various forms. These are all good conduits, but if you look at the scorecard, it's still low. In aggregate between the 6 to 7 trillion of the debt market, or the equivalent size of the Shanghai and Shenzhen composite, only around 2% access is currently available into China. That is low compared to more open markets such as Korea. It's probably closer to 40. So I think going forward, this is a imminent sort of area that needs to be opened up. It's not just about sort of investment coming in, it's also about outbound as well through the QDII. And at the moment, there really isn't, there's a lot of talks about FX volatility, equity stock market volatility, but there really isn't a timing apart from now to a sort of more open up a capital account that allows the balancing of investment flows, allows a more, as the FX goes towards fuller convertibility, interest rate liberalized, we need the final leg to be open up. And from the regulator's perspective, that's the direction. I agree with Andrew, there's an unwavering sort of commitment and conviction to open that up. But if you look at some of the recent sort of regulations on adding reserve costs to FX forward, containing dollar placement offshore, you can tell there are still concerns about China, concerns about stability of the flow. But I think that the truth of the matter is, if you allow a much more open flow, global investors are generally net short of China in the capital market simply because of lack of access. So if you allow them into the debt market, these is a long-only stable liquidity coming into China, you can most likely add to a stabilizing factor to the stock market. You can probably allow a lot more stabilizing factor to the kind of money market volatility we've seen in China in such as 2013. Going forward, corporates in China and international corporates coming into China, they should be looking at funding in a global pool. And China, the size of the market domestically at the moment is still somewhat separated from offshore. So, the opening up of the panda market and as well as continued expansion of dim sum and various other renminbi bond market in the various other hubs should continue to develop, have a free flow of those proceeds in and out of China to allow to simply lubricate the system.
If there were just one or two items that you'd be looking for, what would they be? What would really kind of be a game changer, really?
On capital account items?
Yes.
I think they could definitely, and it's prime time to really open up a much wider scheme into the equity market. I think Stock Connect is not a bad way to open up because instead of a very administrative individual quotas, they just control the speed of capital flow through daily quotas. So that can be widened. And the downside is it's a little bit restricted in terms of point to point. So I don't really think it needs to be Hong Kong, Shanghai Stock Connect. It should just be Connect. Connecting different major cities and sites into China, I think that could be widened. In the bond market, currently it's mainly the major wallet are just central banks are able to access into China's bond market, mainly for various sites to open up their offshore renminbi hub to allow them to have access to invest into the renminbi. That should really open up wider, and the Chinese regulators are already in near its final drafting to allow stable long-term money into the China bond market. I think that would be useful.
Do you think any of those we could see next year?
Very possible.
Very possible. All right. So we're coming to our second audience question. And let me just give you a little background to that. The IMF's managing director, Christine Lagarde, has said in the past that SDR status for the renminbi is a matter of when, not if. And later this year, the IMF actually makes a decision whether to include the renminbi in the basket of currencies that determine the value of the SDR. And should they say yes in their decision at the end of this year, this implementation would take effect in September of next year. So this brings on the second audience question. Can we have the second question, please? Should the IMF add the RMB to the SDR basket in 2016? For to vote no, you push 1. If you want to vote yes, press 2. If you don't know, press 3. So please pick up your handsets and please vote now. No. No says 19.5%. I'm just jotting these down. And yes, 62%. So we can tell the IMF that the SWIFT conference votes yes. And I think we'll let them know. So I'd like to ask each of the panelists to share with us how they voted and to also register not just should the IMF, but will the IMF get the renminbi into the SDR basket next year? And I'll just go down the line.
Sure. So will the IMF? I think the answer will probably be yes. My answer was a no. Reason I say a no is I'd like to see much more capital account convertibility before it becomes a reserve currency. You think about a reserve currency, you want to incent a foreign investor to not just own their own currency, but own somebody else's currency as well. That's what, in simplistic terms, a reserve currency is. To do that, I'd like to see, it's a journey, and I think the renminbi is just at the beginning of that journey. You need a lot more trust, transparency, liquidity for it to really succeed. So. That's the reason I said no. I think it still needs to mature. It still needs time. Will it get there? Absolutely. Will it probably get the vote in 16? Maybe. What I'd urge people to think about is, so what happens when it becomes a reserve currency, right? And what happens when it gets the SDR vote? Yes, sure, there will be some countries that will buy into the renminbi as a reserve currency, but that's not going to change anything in a very material way, in my view. You think of world reserves today, about 70% of the world reserves are in the dollar, about 15% are in the euro, 5% in the sterling, and 5% in the yen, and 5% in everything else. Is that going to change by any order of big magnitude if the vote is yes now? I don't believe so. And then the last thing I'd say is that you might actually have an unintended consequence, given where the Chinese economy is now and the intent for a looser monetary policy to spur growth. If you convert this into a reserve currency, you might actually have inflows coming in into the renminbi, which might end up with a tighter monetary policy implication. So,
Okay. Definitely, IMF should and will, right, add renminbi into the SDR basket. I don't know why they postpone their decision making, right? I don't know. But just as Professor Huang said that states, right? Obama supported, there's no problem, right? And I think that it does make sense to allow renminbi to go to be included in the basket, right? Because according to my knowledge, there are only two currencies are waiting to be included. One is RMB, the other one is a Brazil currency, right? And you know that there are already four currencies in the basket, right? Dollar, euro, Japanese yuan, pound, right? And according to your statistics, RMB already overpassed the Japanese yuan. Now it's number four, right? So it is logical, right, to be included in RMB in the SDR basket. And I just want to ask a question. Do you know why China would like to be included, would like to join the SDR basket? Why? What's the reason? Why? What's the rationale behind China's willingness? Because, you know, we want to RMB to be internationalized, right? This is our national strategy, right? If you join the SDR basket, then the member states of the IMF is obliged to use renminbi as one of their foreign reserves. That's the point, right? So I think for China to be included in SDR is very important. And it does make sense, because another reason is that China, you know, China's import and export foreign trade volume is, according to the statistics last year, 2014, is about $4.3 trillion, which is number one in the world. And from export side, is $2.34 trillion. So there's no reason why China cannot join the basket. So definitely, I think maybe next meeting is September, next September, maybe, right? I do believe that IMF would make a decision to allow China to join the basket. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Liao? Should or and will?
It would be a categorically yes to both, actually, voted yes, and I do think it will go in. And my reasons is, you really need the currency to properly represent where the economy stands in this world, and as the world's biggest trader, and continue to work with, you know, all the central banks in various countries to internationalize the renminbi, which is reflective of, you know, the trade relationship. It really, should be reflected in that importance. When we speak to a lot of the central banks, those who actually invest into China and those who are exploring, simply put, this I think it actually serves as a sort of self-fulfilling prophecy in that a lot of the central banks actually want the SDR to legitimize the renminbi so that they could actually sort of immediately engage into the investment and deployment of the renminbi in their respective sites. So that would help lubricate trade and investment between China and their countries. So I think it should. Andrew talked a lot about the considerations on whether it will. I think it broadly reflects currently the usage of renminbi globally. I think capital accounts do need to open up much wider, as Amol mentioned, but that can come. I don't think this is a 1-2 step. I think that can open up. I think one technical consideration in the IMF also seemed to be the sort of the consideration of whether CNH is renminbi, because it's a currency that's governed outside of China by a different law, by a different circulation. So I think there's some technical consideration and issues there that needs to be ironed out. But it also prompts, I think, to be a true international currency. The domestic currency and the offshore currency need to sort of converge in terms of its governance, in terms of its law, in terms of the sort of the master agreements for the derivatives markets, etc. So there's work to be done, but I don't think these should stop the entry.
Thank you. Dr. Sheng, did you want to comment any more? You said in your first remarks.
Well, yes, I think it's not a question should the IMF add. Does the world need the RMB to join the SDR basket? Absolutely. I would be very worried if the RMB is not in it. And I'll tell you why. Technical and political. On the technical side, as you know, the IMF is a major lender to economies in distress. And is the world going through a secular deflation? Answer is yes. Are the current account surpluses of the emerging markets shrinking very fast? Absolutely yes. So will the IMF need more resources? Yes. And who is going to provide this? The question is that will the Congress allow more funding for the IMF at this point of time? Maybe. So the only, you know, very large economy that will put a lot of resources on the table for the IMF and the Bretton Woods institutions is going to be China, because it's still a surplus economy. And, you know, and people tend to forget this. China is emerging very fast as the second largest consumer for consumer goods. You know, it's moving from a producer to a consumption economy. And that, you know, itself creates a, not just a demand on the trade side, but on the capital goods side. So I think it's very important, both technically and politically, that the renminbi joins the SDR club. Because if it doesn't join, what will happen? The IMF will not have enough funds when the next market gets into trouble, put it this way, right? And after all, the what is the IMF? The IMF is $300 billion balance sheet. That's all it is. So if it doesn't have more capital, and there is renminbi is part of it, so that when People's Bank is willing to, you know, give renminbi and it's some of its foreign exchange to support any special programs for other countries that are in need, it's a very, very important signal to the world that the major surplus and the deficit countries are willing to support economies that are going to run out of foreign exchange. It's an extremely signal for the world. So I would be very worried if the renminbi doesn't join the SDR club in 2016.
Now, this is for any of you that would like to answer. What does China need to do between, I guess it would be now and November, before they vote? Is there anything, or has there been enough?
I think it's a technical issue. Right? As I said, the technical issues are on the capital account side. Now, on the trade side, it's already fulfilled it, as David said. But what? Let's think about the capital account. The capital account really basically says that when you hold renminbi, you should be able to freely buy and sell capital account products. And that's what all the bankers want, and that's very good. Now, if you were to say, well, you know, as some hedge funds are saying, you know, the stock market is in a bubble, the property market is in a bubble, you know, and you can't buy this stuff. Well, guess what's happened? The stock market has adjusted. The bond market, you know, interest rates are becoming more flexible, so that, you know, you could, in certain areas, given the deflation environment when bond prices are also getting more volatile in the advanced markets, even the Chinese, you know, bond market, it is, you know, depending on which way you look at the market, you know, bond market prices are getting buyable, put it this way. And hello, the real estate market has recovered in China. Not in the third and fourth tier cities, but certainly in the first and second tier cities. So to a large extent, the capital account is already becoming, from technical perspective, much more ready for opening, put it this way. So that would then give the authorities greater confidence to say, let's open up. If you don't open, when are you going to open up? So it's already, political commitment is already there for opening up. The only question is when. And that depends upon the technical factors.
Yeah.
You know.
I mean, Andrew, I mean, I totally agree about that. I mean, and the part I want to add is it's almost not contingent upon market timing, right? I mean, you can argue in one sense that you know, the stock market is adjusted downwards, bond market. Bloomberg thinks it's there's a bubble. I don't think so. And the property market is recovering. The fact is, we need the access to know right. Whether we do it or not is a different thing, right? I mean, that's for the investors to decide. But I think these simply need to have a free access, free conversion access, free into these investments. But it's not simply available at the moment.
My point of view is that we are not in rush to open our capital account. And the capital account opening process should be controllable. Otherwise, I think it's a disaster to our country. I can give you an example. On August 11th, right? We call it a reform, maybe, right? Some people say that we abandon the fixing system. No, we just want to try to see how the market will react to renminbi's depreciation. And you know the result, right? Panic. The panic. I can give you an example. My colleague in Singapore told me that during the several days after August 11th, it's a panic on the market. You can't borrow money. Even the ICBC, you know, cannot make some kind of quotation about the interest rate, about the overnight renminbi. So I think that the opening up of our capital account should be controllable, should be a step by step. We cannot do it at once. We cannot do it at one time. I can give you another example. Because of the trend, you know, the renminbi depreciation, more and more people, both individual or corporate, they would like to keep dollar in their account. In their account with Bank of China. Bank of China, Beijing, right? And then we have a lot of dollar money deposit with very cheap. You know, in China, the dollar, the interest rate of dollar deposit is very cheap, right? Very low. And then it provides us a very cheap money. Then we can do some refinancing to our correspondent bank. But you know, last year, or the year before last year, no. We borrow money from our correspondent bank, like Citibank. But this year, we have a lot of dollar. Why? Because of the dollar is expected to rise, right? And renminbi, there's a trend. the market think that renminbi will face the pressure of depreciation again, not only on August 11th, maybe in future, later, again. Also, the our watchdog, you know, also give us a lot of pressure, you know. Ask us, no, don't give us a lot of pressure. If your client are cheating you, right? They want to convert renminbi into dollar, use cheating, just stop it. Otherwise, your bank will be punished. So this is the pressure, right? Definitely we cannot, know a lot of people say that, oh, if you want to be internationalized, right, you must open your capital account at once. No, everything in China is controllable. Our government, it's PBOC, control it. It's not the foreign, not IMF, not the state, not Obama. It's our government.
But you know, I agree with what you say that you know change has to be calibrated and change has to be and cannot be certain. You can't just pull the plug. So I agree that it has to be done slowly. Flip side of it is you do need to be able to get in and out of a currency with ease. Only when you know you can get out do you want to get in. Right, and so I do think that constant opening up of the capital account is incredibly important. There's a lot of good stuff that's already been done, and I think we will hopefully see much more.
Thank you.
Let me just add to this. I was not trying to advocate complete opening of the capital account. I'm also on the side of managing. That's exactly the negotiations that will go on between the IMF. And the People's Bank. On what aspects of it could it open up? All I was just commenting was that, you know, previously when people perceived that the stock market was rising, you know, or as if there was no ceiling, and people thought that the property market was in a bubble, then the conditions would you know, some policymakers would be nervous. But I think the conditions are much, much better now.
Can I just ask a question?
I mean, I'm still inclining towards the opening up of the capital accounts for the reasons I've laid out, not because IMF asked for it, but simply because it helps to balance, you know, investment flow, balance the interest rate liberalization, the FX movements. That's the reason, if PBOC believes that's as such. But I don't think it should be timed cyclically or trying to sort of, you know, if we're just simply trying to bar and contain sort of speculative flow and have a perpetual sort of control on capital accounts, I think we'll lose a lot as a country. You know, I'm just struggling a little bit to you know, because by the reasons you mentioned, Mr. Chen, then the capital accounts for China shouldn't ever be really open, or for that matter, for any country. I think China has, and PBOC has every right and power and ability through foreign exchange reserves as well as monetary policy to control a much wider conduit of the current capital accounts opening up.
It's definitely, you know, it's control. And I can give you another example, you know, on the offshore market, right? The renminbi rise again, right? To beat some people's expectation that renminbi will go on depreciation, right? Some people say that it was controlled by PBOC. On the Hong Kong market, right? Renminbi rise again. I don't know, you know, because I'm not from PBOC, right? But I think it's possible, right? Because, you know, everything is controlled by us. If we cannot control it, definitely we will not do it. We cannot do something that we can't control it in the future, right? Otherwise, it's a disaster for our country. Although we have a huge amount of foreign reserve, it's still $3.51 trillion, you know, a huge amount. But we don't want to do the capital account opening at once, overnight. No, definitely, step by step.
Thank you. So we're going to move on to the last survey question for the audience. Can we have the third question, please? Okay, we've got it. So, from your perspective, when might the renminbi rival the euro? If you think that will happen by 2020, please press 1. By 2025, press 2. 2030, press 3. Or sometime after 2030 or never, you could push 4. So please pick up your handsets and please vote now. So we have 31% saying the renminbi will rival the euro by 2020 within 5 years. More say, 40% say this will happen within 10 years. 15% it will say it will take 15 years, and another 14% say it will take longer or not happen. So just to let you know, I'm going to ask the panel to comment on how they voted and to give a last comment, but I'm also going to ask them to respond to this last question. And then we're going to move on to the Q&A. So get your questions ready, please. So my last question is, if we make the distinction between an international currency, a reserve currency, and a safe haven currency, what gets the renminbi to safe haven status? Something like the dollar or the yen, a currency that rallies when markets are sharply risk averse. So that's my last question. So I'm going to ask all of you to tell us how you voted and then have a go at my question and any final comments that you want to make before the Q&A. So I'll start at you've been last, so I'll give you a go to start first, Dr. Zheng.
Yeah, I think the issue very clearly, I think you've put it very, very well. You know, is it a trading currency? Renminbi is already there, I mean, for trade. Is it a reserve currency? It can be, and that's what is being negotiated. Is it a safe haven currency? Well, safe haven currencies would depend very much upon a very geopolitical questions of which the military part comes into it. And at this present question, there is no doubt in my mind that the US dollar is the safe haven currency. So, and that the US dollar took 70 years to replace sterling as the, you know, safe haven currency. And so, you know, I do not see, you know, China, I mean, the renminbi replacing the dollar as a safe haven currency for quite a number of years. And the reason why I voted for 2025 is that the euro, the loss of the position, the relative position, as Amul has said, pointed out absolutely correctly, is an exchange rate issue. When the exchange rate actually depreciates, the value of the transactions goes down. So to a large extent, as China becomes a bigger economy, you know, at growing at 6%, and as I said, it will be a $20 trillion economy, and at the moment the euro is about $17 trillion economy, by 2025, you know, it probably will match. I mean, will it overtake? I'm not so sure, but it will certainly rival it.
Thank you. Mr. Liao?
I was going to vote, or I think there's every right to vote 2020, but after listening to Mr. Chen, I've just reserved to 2025. I think a lot depends
on... You know my answer, not 25, 30.
Exactly. So I've averaged it out a little bit.
I'm not very optimistic, right? Because, you know, I think that, you know, you can't hope that one day the Rome was built, right? No. We need time, right? Step by step. Everything's controllable. Otherwise, we don't do it. You know, on the basis, our basis, our logic is that we should protect our interest, of our national interest, right? If we open it, it might be beneficial to our country, right? Otherwise, please, step by step, okay?
And so, finished. Are we doing the second
part
of the question?
I'm sorry. Which year did you vote for?
I'm sorry.
No. It's good. Right?
But during the rehearsal, you said that we can use traffic.
Absolutely. So the second part of the question is safe haven.
Yes.
A lot of work to do. I think that the current scene needs. As I mentioned earlier, to be able to trade and fully accessible, and have, you know, based on international standard, based on solid monetary policy, stable regulations, and on top of that, you know, there are sort of geopolitical sort of factors that one has built in. So it's going to take a while for safe haven status, I think.
Yes, for me, I think that definitely from China's view, right, we want to become each currency, right? Trade currency, capital currency, reserve currency, safe haven currency, but it depends. And why I choose 2030, right? Because according to Bank of China analysis, you know, we have our own International Finance Institute. According to our experts, there. Forecast is about, I think it's in 2020, Renminbi will be the third largest, will pass the pound, will be the third largest currency used by traders, you know, in the world. But if we want to catch up with euro, it's a long way to go. Euro is too strong. You know, it's European Union, it's not one country, right? So definitely we need a long time, you know. But we don't care, we step by step, okay? That's it.
Okay.
So this is one thing that Mr. Chen and I actually agree on. So I voted for 2030 as well. But you know, there's different ways you can answer this question, right? If you want to bet on when it's going to overtake the euro on the SWIFT statistics we saw, there's one answer. I mean, that's just the trade bit, right? But if you want to truly rival the euro for what it stands as a reserve currency, as a safe haven currency, it's a long way off. It's a long way off. In terms of closing comments, I'd just say that you know, there are many events and many milestones that we'd like to see the Renminbi hit. One is you need a far stronger clearing infrastructure. I mean, today, the clearing for a Renminbi, I mean, you think about a Brazilian importer wanting to pay in Renminbi instantly. It's still a very painful process, and the fact that you know that whole clearing infrastructure is broken up into many zones just makes it even more tougher. Liquidity gets shrunk. So we'd like to see a far stronger clearing infrastructure, much like what CHIPS and Fedwire does for the US. And I know SIPS just started its pilot just last week. Early days, very nascent, but that's got to get and catch fire and you know become a very meaningful way to move the renminbi around as a value of payment and currency. The second thing I'd say is just the commingling of what is CNH and CNY. They're really different currencies with different yield curves, different exchange rates, so that needs to get together. You need much bigger bond markets so that investors can you know hold the currency in an asset overseas. Those are short term, and then longer term, what I'd say is really there's a bunch of softer things, and the softer things are around trust, transparency, and confidence in the currency in being able to come out, and I said this earlier, which gives you the confidence to go into the currency.
Thank you. I think that's a very nice summary, and I think it's a perfect time to open up the questions to our audience. So if you have a question, please raise your hand and a microphone will find you. Someone with a paddle is going to be...
This one right here.
And when you ask your question, please state your name and your organization. So number one.
Hi, my name is Ian Shi. I'm from the Corporate Treasurer cover, covering APAC markets, especially China and ASEAN markets. In mid-September, Indonesia's SOE minister actually proposed that as the two countries' economic cooperation will grow wider and will keep grow, that it should be considered that there's an option for direct rupiah and renminbi transactions between the two countries. And there was even a proposal that for ASEAN markets, as China is the biggest trading counterparty for currencies in those markets, it also should be under consideration that the currencies can refer to the renminbi's value instead of dollar. So my question is to all the panelists on stage. Is there a possibility that driven by market forces, even without full capital account convertibility of the currency, renminbi can be a reserve currency for some markets? And secondly, if that happens, what would be the implications for real economies in those markets, i.e. corporations, and even corporations beyond those markets? Thank you.
Okay, that was kind of long. So, okay, go for it.
I think that's an excellent question. I think the first point I want to make is that the TPP is very good for ASEAN, just like OBOR is very good for ASEAN. And the reason why you have TPP, RCEP, and all this is because geopolitically, everybody needs ASEAN. I think that's the first and fundamental point. Now, on a technical issue about whether renminbi can be a reserve currency, look very closely at the bilateral agreement between People's Bank and Bank Negara Malaysia. Under that agreement, actually, as you know, there's a swap arrangements between the two currencies. There is a linkage in which all trade transactions between Malaysia and China can link with that bilateral swap, which means that you can denominate the letter of credit in either renminbi or in ringgit, and then you can get facilities from the central bank on that basis. So in that regard, actually the mechanism already exists for the rupiah renminbi transaction. And I'm sure if the Bank Indonesia has a negotiation with People's Bank, along the same lines as the Bank Negara one, it can be done tomorrow. I'm not speaking on behalf of People's Bank or anybody, but I think technically it's already there. So I think to that extent, that is why already certain emerging market central banks are already holding renminbi as part of their reserves. So de facto, in that sense, it's already a reserve currency.
Yeah. I agree. It's already a reserve currency, even of the existing capital account restriction. And so it's absolutely possible.
All right. Thank you. Number two. No? Okay, no number two. Number five, I see. Is there anyone else who'd like to ask a question? I don't see anyone. Okay. Well, this is actually perfect timing because we're just supposed to wrap up at 12:30. And so I would just like to say thank you very much to the panel for their valuable insights. And also thank you to the audience for your participation in the survey and your attention. So with that, we conclude.